present today our speaker, Ruth Aliabadi, who is wonderfully a Pitt alum, so I think some of you know many already in the room. He graduated with an MPIA from GISBIA in 2008. He is currently a partner at Global Growth Advisors, a small investment and specialty strategic advisory firm in New York. And he's a frequent advisor to the Iranian political establishment on matters of trade, connectivity, and foreign policy. He served an advisory role in the 2013 presidential campaigns in Iran. And in 2015, he was appointed as the senior advisor to the Director of Strategic Studies at Iran's Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the Institute for Political and International Studies in Tehran. Ruth was born in Tehran, but immigrated to the U.S. in 1999. He has served in the U.S. Army Special Operations Command. And while at Pitt, he helped to establish the American Middle East Institute. In the past, he has also served on the board of World Affairs Council and the Center for Iranian Music at Carnegie Mellon University. It should be a really fascinating, wonderful talk. This is part of our series on politics and policy in along the Silk Road. This is a monthly event, so please make sure you sign in on the sheet that's going around, and we'll be sure to let all of you know when we have it all figured out what will be happening with this series in November. So join me in welcoming Roozbeh.
Thank you, Don. I have to thank everyone, in particular Professor Moses Ashley, for arranging this. You know, I tell you what, I do speak or talk to government officials, in particular in Iran, but that's much easier. I don't know why am I more nervous talking to a university crowd. But at any rate, it's such a great honor for me to be here, to be among you, and to discuss something that at least in the past two and a half years, I saw as becoming more relevant, at least to the part of the world that I spent most of my time in. So I thought, rather than talking about big concepts, I keep it very short and tell you a few stories that I've experienced in the past few years, and we'll just take it from there. We can have a lively discussion, and we see, hopefully we'll make it, we'll be on time. So we've got 12:06, so I'll keep my presentation short, about 10-15 minutes, and then we'll take it from there. By the way, I was very impressed to see Mac computers at Pitt, most of them regular PC, so I have to say that. So I don't know if just the Center for International Studies or others, other departments are like this as well. I'd like to start by taking you back to February 15, 2016. That day I was in Tehran. If you want to look at Tehran, this is Tehran in the wintertime. It was looking at a beautiful mountain chain called Alborz Mountain, and a megacity of 14 million nighttime population and roughly around 17 million daytime population. There is a city next to Tehran, it's called Karaj. Nowadays, we better call it Tehraj, kind of Tehran Karaj. We're looking at roughly around a population of 23 million people living in this proximity of roughly around a radius of about 27 to 28 kilometers. So, February 15, I woke up in the morning as usual, listened to my NPR news in the morning, and I was heading to work. And if you're familiar with Tehran in the post-sanction era, in particular post-JCPOA era, it kind of reminds you of what Lenin once said. He says, there are decades where nothing happens, and there are weeks where decades happen. And that was our mood in Tehran, that, oh boy, a lot of things are changing, and they're changing so rapidly, we don't know where to start from, we don't know what to do, and so on and so forth. Tehran traffic, it makes you contemplate about life, because you're always stuck in traffic for hours, and this is what it usually looks like, me going from home, from my apartment, to my work, which is in central Tehran, on a street which is called Pahlavi or Vali Ash, as we call it today, which is the longest street in the Middle East, about 23 kilometers long. It's a Broadway of Tehran, the Broadway street of Tehran. If you live in big cities, you typically see as you go to you go on the streets, you see newspaper kiosks. And in Tehran, it's quite customary. You see in the morning people stand by these newspaper kiosks and looking at the papers and what's happening in the world, in a way. And that day, quite contrary to what I thought, one of the big news. So every time the Supreme Leader of Iran, Ayatollah Khamenei, speaks, we typically have his news or his remarks be on the headline news. So that was one of the news I saw on the newspaper. And the second piece of news was about the SWIFT. SWIFT opened up in Iran. Thanks to the Treasury, the biggest, I think Treasury guys used this term. They said, let's go nuclear on Iran. What they meant was SWIFT. So they unnuked the nuclear option with Iran. SWIFT opened up in Iran. And there was a German delegation that was coming. And the fourth one was an OPEC meeting agreed on increasing Iran's oil quota in the market. But none of them were on the big font news of any of these newspapers. In fact, what was on the front of these newspapers was this picture. A train that took 14 days to reach Tehran with 32 containers, which was loaded with Chinese goods, and took roughly around a 9,500-kilometer journey from south of Shanghai through Central Asia to Iran. Well, this train came or arrived Tehran roughly around 2 weeks after Xi Jinping made the historic visit to the Middle East end of January to Saudi Arabia, where he pledged that he's going to increase the trade between the two countries from $53 billion annually to $600 billion in the next 10 years. So the biggest news was not about lifting the nuclear sanctions. It wasn't about Supreme Leader speaking about ramifications of the nuclear sanctions or JCPOA or SWIFT or any other things. It was about the Silk Road, if you will, which cut the travel time for logistical purposes from Shanghai to Bandar Abbas by roughly around 30 days. This was the biggest accomplishment. Folks, I grew up in Iran. I spent a good bit of time in Iran. I've never seen news such as that become the cover of a newspaper and, frankly, the most important conversation. I developed a friendship with the Chinese ambassador. He's a really cool guy. Chinese ambassador in Tehran, Ambassador Sang, is a student of English literature. And he loves proverbs. And every time him and I talk about various things, he talks to me about, he teaches me one Chinese proverb all the time. But what he did tell me, he said, "Bruce, do you know why such news took priority over other news?" It's because Iranians, and Chinese are playing what we call casual modernization. We started it 20 years ago, and you're starting it today. And frankly, our catch-up modernization is a replacement for us for global hegemony, and your catch-up modernization is becoming a replacement for your regional hegemony. And I kind of like what he said, but what he also told me, he said, "Bruce, remember this program. The best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago, and the second best time is now." And that's what Chinese have to do. And that's what we have to do as the United States, in particular Washington, in the post-nuclear sanction era. What the ambassador was talking about, in fact, what we see on the cover of newspaper, was about the renaissance of what I call the Silk Road. Silk Road is not a new topic. We'll go through it. It has been introduced to us in many different ways. But what we're really seeing, in a way, is we're seeing this common market that's connecting the Russian Federation, EU, the Arab League, the African Union, the Southeast Asian nation, ASEAN nations, and so on and so forth, all together. And this area that includes Central Asia, and I asked Dr. Martinez-Shirley, I said, what's Central Asia? Could Iran be included? She said, yes. I asked her, could Iran be excluded? She said, yes. So, so the fact is that the Central Asia, if I want to really define this market, let's just call it a common market. Common market, that means all these geometric shapes that you see have a common market, which is here. So geography does matter in this context. I just want to share with you a couple of statistics. I don't want to go through them. It would look like a World Bank or IMF lecture. Not that I'm worthy of such lectures, but I'm saying it's, I don't want to go through charts. But the bottom line is, if you want to compare the Silk Road to global common markets, this is where we're looking at in terms of populations, perhaps in the United States, a little bit lower. Or we look at it in terms of economic growth, probably comparable to Canada or Australia, as we know it today. Or in terms of when we're looking at it in terms of talent capacity, and the talent capacity is very much comparable to very vibrant markets in Brazil and Japan and Indonesia. So this is what this common market looks like. Typically, what we want to do, I don't want to dive into it, I just want to give you a feeling of where we stand. When at the Department of Strategic Initiatives at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, we talk about trade, we talk about these things. For example, where do we stand in terms of these big markets in terms of tariff trade restrictions compared to other markets, compared to the Arab market, GCC market, so on and so forth. So this is where we are. Or in terms of logistics and infrastructure, this is where the Chinese saw. They saw in terms of logistics and infrastructure index, this common market is very much underdeveloped. So there's a tremendous amount of room for development for, if you go for this market. Then also market access and population. This is important. The first time I went to Iran, 2009, after Gisbia, I met with the head of the publication called ECO, Economic Cooperation Organization, and he took me to meet with the Iran and the Kazakh ambassador to Tehran. And he says he told me that the best legacy of Russian communism was education in Central Asia, and you really can look at it, and you can look at education. You look at compared to the United States, which represents roughly about 88%. And the majority of these countries, despite what you think, education is very key, and probably in some of those countries, like Kazakhstan or Georgia, is beating, if you will, where we stand compared to the United States. But it's a big difference between education and relevant training and retraining. Now, we don't want to dive into that, but one of the big problems we have in common markets today is retraining in particular. Let me give you an example. Today, I have somebody studies, let's say, global political economy at a similar university, let's say, in Iran. What are the chances he or she will learn about network programming or Python or so on and so forth? That's the biggest difference that we see, for example, I think, in American education compared to what you're seeing over there. So human capital, we're not going to get into that. Underutilization of the workforce is a huge problem in the region, and also is a huge opportunity, in particular female underutilization of the workforce. I'll go back to Ambassador Sang one more time. As we were talking, him and I met probably around once a month, and we talked about different things. And one of the things, it's not a quote from him, but he told me, he said, amateur talk strategy, whereas professionals talk logistics. Us Chinese are professionals. We like to talk about logistics. A year ago, we started looking at the Department of Strategic Initiatives a bit different. We said, our job is not to talk about right brand strategies. Our job would be to look at maps. The maps that we look today are very much so static political maps, just steadily at this one. So in a way, if you really want to understand what's happening in the world, you really have to come up with a good map that will tell you what's happening and what we can do in terms of not just understanding what's happening today, but also forecast what's going to happen in the future. So this is a project from Harvard. Is it visible or is it not that visible? It's not that visible. Is this a light?
I think it's the red
button. Is it better? Okay. So what I'm looking at, this is a Harvard project, and I think University of Madison, Wisconsin does a similar project. It's called Connectivity Atlas. And what we're doing here is we're starting to make layers on the maps. And the map of the future that we're looking at is very different from the map that we actually learned back in school. So what I just did, so this is a pure political map. But what we're seeing here is we're which are urban areas that we have, we're seeing in Eurasia, and even still in Eurasia today. Now I just added another layer, which are the ports. Just taking another layer, these are the airports. Major airports. I just added the minor airports. These are the rivers. These are the main railways. These are the main within-land railways. I'm adding canals. I'm adding gas pipelines, oil pipelines, and last but not least, I'm adding aviation routes that are connecting these cities. Yeah. So what you're seeing essentially is you're actually, I tell you what you don't see. You don't see the political act anymore. In fact, what you're seeing here is this global connectivity revolution. I know these are the terms you probably read when you are going to the airport and picking up a book by various authors that are talking about these grand concepts. But the truth of the matter today is the lines that are seen here, or we're seeing here, are the lines that are connecting us. The volume of the lines that are connecting us are far more than the lines that are dividing us. And if this is the story that we're looking at, therefore, truly what we are being, or the world we're living in a way, is the supply chain of how we're functioning, rather than looking at those dysfunctional political geographies that we saw in the first layer of the mass that we did. I just got rid of the, if you will, airline routes to make the map less busy, and I just added the future maps. Now these are, if you see this, these are all the high-speed railways the Chinese are building in the next 20, 25 years. And I think they are thinking about building it. They are building it. Firsthand, I've seen one project going connecting Tehran, capital of Iran, to the ancient city of Isfahan, which is an amazing, amazing high-speed railway. And Chinese won the contract, and they're building it right now. And if you look at the future canals that they're building for agricultural purposes, or electricity grid they're building in northern part of Africa, in particular, they're building it in DRC, they're building it in Tanzania and elsewhere. And in fact, if we're looking at it this way, so if we're thinking functionally rather than politically, then we're focusing on how this map, in a way, could be optimizing land, it's optimizing labor, capital, and frankly, how it's really trying to put us in these difficult clusters. Now, why am I telling you these stories? I'm telling you these stories because if this is the map that we're looking at in the future, and planet Earth was had a Facebook account, I think its status would have been very complex. Or, complex doesn't mean more unpredictable in this sense. Complex in this sense means perhaps even more predictable if we can manage it. I showed that to my mom. My mom was like, it looks like Jackson Pollock. Jackson Pollock painting. So I figured I would put it here. But what essentially what you're seeing, this is a Jackson, if you're confusing, this is a Jackson Pollock painting, and this is the connectivity map that we're looking at. But truly what we're seeing is we're seeing borders collapsing, and we're seeing demographics blending. And this is the story of Eurasia today, in my opinion. This is the story that we're seeing it much, much more often. Or at least this is the story that we're feeling it much more than perhaps we're thinking about it here in the United States. This hyper-connected and hyper-competitive supply chain, what it teaches us as a, I talked to a lot of repats, not expats, a lot of repats, Iranian-Americans, and they tell me that when we're looking at these maps in Central Asia and these Commonwealth areas, we just realize being American is no longer enough. You really have to be competing on many more fronts when you're coming back. So what they were telling me is essentially this is becoming extremely, extremely competitive. So what the Chinese have realized, this is a map we have in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. If you watch the Iran nuclear talks, you've seen the deputy minister named Araghchi. Abbas Araghchi was the deputy minister of foreign affairs, and he has the same exact map in his office in Tehran. map that actually he got from a company called Sinopec, that most of us are familiar with, and he got it while he was the ambassador to Japan. And when he got this from a Sinopec official, the Sinopec official says, there is no better investment for us than connectivity, Mr. Ambassador. And he kept this map. And this is a mindset of the people that were talking to the United States for the P5 plus one, remember, that went on and went through the nuclear negotiations. But in the back of their mind, I think they only want the different idea. Not putting a lid on the nuclear program in Iran, per se, but what's going to get us closer to connectivity. Nothing tells us, in fact, in my opinion, about the future of geopolitics. They're really trying to, in this sense, trace the infrastructure plans on the ground. And that's what we haven't done now. I'm more optimistic. This is about stability and stability of Central Asia. I'm more optimistic about the stability of Central Asia because today when we're looking at the global defense spending, and I'm not the IE major, with all due respect to IE majors, and I'm not a do-gooder here, but these are the facts that we're seeing on the ground. Today, our defense spending and trajectory of our defense spending is such a linear path, and this is the growth of it. But today, if you add the infrastructure spending in the world, this is what we're seeing. So what essentially we're seeing is today, the cost of destruction is becoming immensely higher than what it was, let's say, 2 decades ago, 3 decades ago, 4 decades ago. And I think the cost is going to continuously grow. I'm not going to talk about this much. This is about Cold War. We can dive into it, but this is one of the big things that in the common markets we're concerned about. One belt, one road. We can talk about it down the road. But this is essentially what it's telling us is China today is more, has been marked on economic liberalization far more quickly than political democratization. And this is one example of it that we can see. Through this fast. Just here, I just wanted to show you that China is not interested just in exporting things. This shows that China is interested in export of capital, but also people too. So we are already seeing it today in just in Iran alone, we have roughly around 150,000 Chinese workers. Today in Iran alone, we have roughly about 20,000 Chinese factory managers. These numbers are growing. And China is therefore not buying the world per se, but in exchange for resources, natural resources, and they're doing it very, very well. In fact, the most significant intervention that I would say, geopolitical intervention, that will prove not to be the military one that we saw in Afghanistan, perhaps in Iraq, in Syria, or previously in Libya, but it's going to be the one of infrastructure. These are some of the Cold War agreements and implementations. We're not going to go through these. There's going to be a lot of them. But what I wanted to tell you today is also Cold War itself, or this, I shouldn't call it the Chinese vision, I should call it the Eurasian vision, is really indeed impacting the demographic trends within China. We think in the next 10 to 15 years, China's Western province is going to be one of the most key and core provinces than China's Eastern provinces. As we are seeing this quadrupling of China's energy consumption, as we are seeing this one belt, one road being indeed the most, in our opinion, the most important investment plan of the past 5 centuries, within China we are due to some big changes. Some opportunities within Cold War, we're not going to get into that, but this is really important. Asia infrastructure investment plan. When I was in ISPO, I remember we did projects talking about the World Bank, IMF, Washington Consensus, the impact of financial markets as we know it, the Western financial market, the post-Brexit financial markets, and what would it mean to us. But today, it's really interesting. When we look at Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, which is by far, I think, would be the most influential and most dominantly speaking of any of the financial institutions in the next few decades. Do you know it's the first member of Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank? Any guesses? China? China was the first member who signed to be a member? Okay, United Kingdom was the first member of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. In fact, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank is not very, much so a Chinese organization as much as, in our opinion, it's a Eurasian organization. AIIB is budgeted to spend about 10 times as what in Asia as what Marshall Plan has spent in Europe. Now, thinking about the Silk Road, I know that the topic is about the Silk Road, but throughout the history, when we look at the Silk Road, I think I would argue the Silk Road sort of throughout the history accomplished the same sort of thing of what globalization is accomplishing today. So really nothing has changed. Time has changed, the dynamics have changed, but it remains the same. This is a blue and red and blue map that I wish we shared more in the presidential elections here in the States, that we saw those wonderful colors in the background of what I don't call campaigns. And this is not, I'm not making a political statement, I'm just making a conscious statement. Today, the largest trading partners, 56 countries are the largest, have the United States as their largest trading partners, whereas China has 124. Today, the way I see our presidential candidates are arguing sometimes against globalization is the way, they're arguing against the law of gravity. And that's, in fact, a sad part. In fact, globalization, this can show you that has entered, in a way, this new golden age, which is tells us, rightly so, that it is not the same thing as Americanization. People in the Asian continent have realized that. And I think the sooner that we realize it here, it would probably give us better tools and better expectations to manage what we're going to stand and what we're going to do in this environment. I love stories. I don't want to keep it dry, so I give you this story. So quite often we get called in to go talk to the office of the president in Iran, President Rouhani. He's a funny guy. He is a funny guy, I give you that. So this is the office of the president in Tehran. And we were supposed to be talking about public policy, which I have no idea what we were going to talk about. But I actually took one of the slides from the presentations and I wanted to actually bring it up here. And this is a conversation the Rouhani administration was having with its executive branch, if you will, in Tehran. How to move forward. And these are the terms, I translated from Farsi. How to become wealthy, orderly, efficient, and honestly governed nation. We need clear-eyed, blunt-speaking Jewish strategies. Western democracy is not working. Well, now you're missing Iran, so we need meritocracy. I went back to see where they got this slide from. I asked the person that presented it. They took it from a slide deck from Kazakhstan, where there was a teach on public policy to Kazakh public servants being taught by the Lee Kuan Yee School out of Singapore. I simply found it fascinating. I thought I should include it here. This is what the Iranian government today, I'm not saying doing, but thinking about today. We don't have time to go through data, but I think one of the biggest things that we neglect today is digital Silk Road. It's going to have far more important, I think, implications for us as a country here in the United States, especially if you're a SIS major, in terms of geopolitics of the internet, not in the internet, because geopolitics in our internet is really where we're going to have these data hubs, which is a different conversation. And but I think it's worth paying attention to, in particular within the Silk Road. McKinsey has done a good job. McKinsey, ever since the nuclear deal, opened up an office in Tehran, McKinsey Global Institute for, and I know they're hiring big time, so if you're about to graduate, take a look at McKinsey. And I like what they did with the flow of information and the flow of services. I'm not going to go through the numbers, but the numbers, what we here in the States often miss is how the thickness of these lines are changing. This is 2001, the flow of services. Okay? This is 2011. This is the 2002 flow of finance. 2012. This is 2019-80 for goods, 2011 for people, and communications. This is what we need. Don't think when we talk about Silk Road, we're talking about some exotic routes. We're also talking about a little bit of fashion, and I wanted to kind of include that in the presentation. Anybody knows what we're looking at? Sneakers, okay, but what kind of sneakers?
Nike.
People, if you have a young cousin, younger cousin, ask your younger cousin, and if they're a Kobe Bryant fan, that did they follow what happened on March 21st, 2015? Kobe Bryant Nike Silk Road edition came out. This is some Nike Silk Road, guys. And in fact, the designer took the idea from the silver because Kobe Bryant grew up in Italy and traveled to China. And so the colors resembled the caravanserais or the guest houses and so on and so forth. So it is quite, yeah, Silk Road is bad in a big way and it's quite fashionable. Now, we're familiar with Hermes. The price tag for this one of Samarkand is pretty high. Samarkand is an ancient city in the Silk Road. And the price tag is quite high, but I really like this sentence. The name Samarkand is a homage of the city through which spice caravans once passed on their way from east to west. When we think about the Silk Road, we always think about east to west or west to east. Oftentimes we ignore what happens within the Silk Road, which I think is instrumentally important if we want to really understand where we're going to go and what role we have. No doubt, Iran is indispensable missing link in the region for integration for the common market. But today, if we look at these markets, I would argue for the small or rather large landlocked countries in the Central Asia, connectivity is the strategy. Although I was surprised to see the train making that voyage from south of China going over through Central Asia to come to being the most important news. Does make sense. Why? Because it is about connectivity. It is about the future of strategy and what these people are, what these countries are thinking about. Let's go back to February 15th. Same day. I don't really know what my day was like. I have it on my calendar. I looked at it. It didn't make much sense. But I was going back on leaving the office and going home. And on the same way, I was going back, same newspaper kiosk was there. But this time, I knew what the headlines would be.